Yo, what up, YouTube world? Today, I got a very special guest, my brother Jabril, aka Mr. Passport Heavy, aka Getting to the Money. What's up, my man? How you doing, sir?
What's up, man?
Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Yeah, man. So, you know, before we met, I was, you know, I was in the process of just researching places to visit in Africa, and I YouTube everything.
Yeah.
If it's a hotel I've never stayed in, I'll see what room I want. I'll YouTube that exact room.
Yeah.
It's always on there. Like, I YouTube everything.
Yeah.
Somebody doing a review. So I was reviewing Ghana and Nigeria, and came across your channel. You know, he has a channel called Passport Heavy, and you broke down everything so dope.
Yeah.
And you showed the country in such a beautiful way. And you showed other places like Bali and Indonesia and all these other places. Y'all really got to check his channel out. It's dope. And one thing I really liked about your channel, bro, I think it was a Bali video, and you was breaking it down how to do it on if you had a $40,000 budget,
yeah,
an $80,000 budget, 20, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I think that's very, very valuable because people, you know, sometimes people will do things from their own perspective and that's it. Yeah. And some people are like, yeah, I can't do it like that. And yeah, it may turn people off from doing things. But you show how now you can travel to these dope places on whatever budget.
Yeah.
And it's all good.
Nah, man. I think it's super important, right? So what you see in the background right now is like my homie Brett, quarterback of the Cardinals. Like, okay, he actually reached out. He's watching the videos on social media. And it's kind of crazy because I was like, man, I'd never imagined NFL players. Like, I've been watching you from afar for, you know, for years, just the fitness space.
Right.
And, you know, just an icon in, you know, in the industry. And the reason I broke down the prices is because, like, the average income in the United States for individuals is like $40,000 a year.
Mm-hmm.
Not everyone lives. Not everyone's got a budget like Mike or you know, like Hov.
Okay, my budget is $45,000 a year.
Right? Or, you know, like Hov.
Right.
And so, but that don't mean that you can't travel,
right,
around the world. And that's the perception that people have. They're like, mm-hmm, oh, I can't go that far. And so I said, I was going to these places like Thailand or Colombia. And then you might have the hesitation before of, oh shit, Colombia. Okay, can I curse on your
We encourage profanity.
Okay, I like shit, man. You know, so you'd be like, damn, I don't even know if it's safe in these places. So there's certain criteria that I knew my homies would want to know back home,
mm-hmm,
before going to places. And that's how I make the videos. Like, I'm talking to my boys back home. So they want to know about the nightlife. They want to know about the culture. What do the women look like there? And then what people tend to exclude, especially with some of these influencers, because they're getting paid to go to these places, they staying in $1,000 a night rooms. I'm like, that's just not realistic.
It's not.
Like,
yeah,
even,
yeah,
like, I don't even pay $1,000 a night, right, just on the regular,
right,
like that.
Right.
And so I said, let me, what's realistic for someone? And then plus, I was like, what if you make $300,000 a year? What if you make a million? There's also options for you. So in a place like Thailand, for example, I first backpacked through Thailand,
mm-hmm,
and with my boys, so they graduated university. I mean, I didn't go to university, but they're like, yo, we're looking to do this trip. They knew I worked online for myself with my marketing company, so I could travel anytime. And then I went there, and we were, you know, literally you could get an apartment, like a real nice apartment, for like $300 a month, where I'm talking about you got a doorman,
wow,
you got a pool.
And where was this?
In Chiang Mai, Thailand.
Okay.
Or you could be in Bangkok. And then, you know, a gym, talking about gym.
Right.
All right, you got all that. And then it's also modern and developed,
right,
too. So that's one thing. It's not.
See, that's the thing that people don't realize the value you bring to your channel is because, yeah, you, like, we were talking about Africa earlier, yeah, Ghana and Nigeria. People think that, you know, the perception is it's just kids with flies in their eyes.
Yeah.
But nah, it's dope. It's fly and it's modern. You,
yeah,
know what I mean?
Yeah. So
people, like, wouldn't know that without channels like yours.
No, man. I appreciate that. And so, I mean, just to finish up on Thailand, right? And so you could go, if you want to go party, a bottle of Jack Daniels in the club in Chiang Mai, $35. Like in Chicago.
That's like the real price.
Like the real price. And then so I was like, damn. Like, this is crazy. So even for me, one of my big things that I like to push is this new digital economy. So you can work remotely. And so if you live in California or you just want to go experience these different cultures, like, to live a decent life, I would say in Cali, you, I mean, when you're not, like, well, you can take Ubers and really enjoy life. You gotta spend about 10 bands a month. Like, if you go, like, have a nice apartment, you're going out for dinner, you're not like, you saving a little bit.
That's unless you got four roommates. It's right? expensive out here.
Right? Yeah. And so, when I saw this other place, and then now with internet's faster, all these things, I say, you can live, your money goes about. So if you spend 10 there, I mean, spend 10 here, you can spend about 2,000 and have that same type of lifestyle. And then another thing is, you also get like this exoticness about you. So here, you just another motherfucker. Mm-hmm. And out there, they're like, okay, this.
Right. You're a little special to the natives, to the locals.
That. And then also all these other, women travel. I mean, I got a girl now, so I'm just like,
But before,
it was like, yeah, you living your best life.
Hey, one thing I noticed, man, like when I started traveling different countries, they kind of like us.
Oh,
in a lot of places, it's absolutely. Like we're exotic. I'm like, okay, I love your accent. Okay, sure. Yeah. You know what I mean? It's cool.
Yeah, because America, that's the thing. America's been marketed across the world. And to go back to Ghana, so like my heritage is Nigerian. Mm-hmm. And I know you said, a lot of your bloodline, you did your DNA test, you know, a lot of it's from Ghana. Like, you know, those are like brothers. Like, it's like brother and sister, yeah, real like close.
They border.
Yeah, they border each other. And so growing up, it was like, I mean, just to keep it 100, it was like African wasn't the swag. It was like, you know, African booty scratcher.
Right.
And
you know what's funny? Like, that was something that we said to bag on people, but what the fuck does that mean? It's stupid. It means nothing. African booty scratcher.
Right? And it's like, what does it even mean? And now the thing is, the marketing campaign for the country, or just the continent and whole, not just Ghana, but I mean the whole continent, is, you know, like you were saying, flies in faces. You're either going for a mission trip to be the savior, to go save people there.
Right, right.
And it's like, that's the only narrative that's been shown. So I said, man, it's different. There's two sides to this story. And then so let me go ahead and show people, yo, they've got, lifestyle. They've got culture. They've got history, rich history, right?
Heavy. Yeah.
Intelligent people. They're advancing. And if you want to do the nice shit, like I'm rolling around in a Bentley in Ghana. They've got the dope.
I seen you in the Musan out there.
You know, and then it's like, you can also get nice cribs. People, when I was putting on the gram, they was like, where you at, man? I was like, I'm in Ghana. They're like, Ghana? They got shit like that in Ghana? And so I like to educate people that there's more to the continent than just what you see.
And it's a big world out there. And, you know, people, like different civilizations advance by traveling and exploring and, mm-hmm. and going on new frontiers. And the same with us. I know that my perspective changed big time the first time I traveled abroad. Mm-hmm. You know, my first time going abroad, I was gone for over a year.
Okay.
And man, I came back a better person, just more knowledgeable about other things and just learning from different people, different cultures. And, you know, the things, the preconceived notions that we may have, mm-hmm. like, you know, I was in the Middle East for like 8 months.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to lie, I was programmed by our news. You know what I'm saying? Wow. So I was out there like, nervous,
right.
But yo, these were the nicest fucking people in the world. You know what I'm saying? So it was like, okay, it helped me not just for that, but just in life in general to not take on the common perspectives and just to go and learn on my own, go and fill things out on my own. You know what I mean? Before I can, you know, actually assess something before having a notion on what everybody else says it is. You know what I mean?
No, 100, you're built to fear based on media. Like, I would not have been so many places if it wasn't for some of my friends that have been and invited me to go to places, because I'm like, man, nah, fuck that. Like, when the first time I went to Colombia, I went because I had some friends that invited me down.
Mm-hmm.
And so I feel like I'm almost an ambassador also for, like, my people to show them, like, the way in these different places, because I know for a fact, I'm like, man, all I see is narcos. I hear people talking about, yo, I got the plug down in Colombia, all this. And if you don't have any type of connection, of course you're going to be spooked. You don't want to put yourself in danger.
Right.
And so when I went and experienced it for myself, I was like, man, what else could they be lying to me about? Like, what else could I go experience in the world? Because this is, I'm having a completely different experience
than I thought
mm-hmm. I was going to have based on what I've seen. And I was like, let me go see this you know, Panama Plate. Let me go see Asia. Let me go to Africa. Let me go to these places. Even so, here's another crazy place that I went. I went to Ukraine, right? And so my only thing, my picture of, let me just to keep it, you know, 100 is like racism. I thought, you know, you just think of like the soccer games, they throwing bananas, like, you know, calling right. them monkeys. And I'm not to say like there's not issues and stuff over there, but like I go into a lot of these places real apprehensive
right.
because that's all that's programmed in my mind. Mm-hmm. And I went there, man, and I had the time of my life. People were really, we got lost the first night we rolled up. And I was asking for direct. I was nervous to like, I was like, are they just going to be like, get away?
Right.
So low up, they're like, oh no. Dude walked with me for 5 minutes to show me the way to go. Like, hell never happened.
You know what's crazy, man? Like, I experienced such similar things. When my first time going to Germany, I went from the Netherlands. I took a train. And I'm like, yo, I'm thinking Nazi Germany, and the conductor on the train sound like Hitler. Like, but when I got there, bro, these were the nicest people on the planet. Like, it was so cool and so yeah. nice. And the same thing when I was in Abu Dhabi, Dubai, Ras Al Khaimah, Sharjah, it was like I'd be in the cab, and it's a lot. So for those who don't know, in the United Arab Emirates, that's where Dubai is at. Sometimes I say Dubai, yeah. but the country, people think that's a country. It's just a yeah. small emirate or a state. The country is the United Arab Emirates, UAE. And the locals are a minority there. And the majority of people is Indian, Pakistani, Afghani, Philippine, African. So that's normal out there. So I'll be in a taxi, and they don't know if when I'm yeah. African, whatever, French. And when they hear me speak, they like, Ameriki, you know, as an American, they'll stop the car. Please come up front. Please, please, please. They want to hold your hand. Because out there, that's what they do. Like yeah. friends, men will hold hands. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And they're just so pleasant and so nice. They just want to do for you and make sure you're good. Yeah. I experienced that in like Australia as well. Like people, like being at an expo out there, they're like, so how you doing? How you liking it out here? Like they yeah. want to just conversate and know how you're doing. It's yeah. just so positive. And it's such a refreshing thing because here in America, I feel like the default way to be is skeptical, kind of like standoffish. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And my experience at expos here versus abroad, here people are like trying to like get something from me
yeah, yeah.
or be a part of or whatever mm-hmm. these other places. They like, man, good job on this. And man, like, how you doing?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, thank you. How you doing? You know what I'm saying? So it's real cool. Like, people in different... See, I learn from these people. I learn from everything. Yeah. When I see people with really dope characteristics, I'm like, I'm going to be more like that too.
Yeah.
And I try to pick up on that, you know?
Definitely.
Yeah. What places did you go? Because I know you stayed... I know you do Bali for like 5-6 months. And
yeah.
Is that your favorite place to be? What's your favorite place to be?
Man, that's a tough question. And I get this question all the time. What is my favorite place to be? Man, it depends on my mood. And also it depends on who I'm with, right? But if I first talk about Bali, the reason I love Bali so much, I feel at peace when I touch down in Bali.
Mm.
The people...
What is it about it that make you feel so peaceful?
So the energy of the people, the energy of the island is, you know, is incredible. It sounds funny, but I know I'm gonna have good internet since I work a lot. Like I stress out if I don't have solid internet
right.
and good Wi-Fi. I don't need to be on all the time, but mm-hmm. just to know that I can work. So that's just like a thing when I travel around the world. I know, and it sounds crazy, but this is what me personally.
Mm-hmm.
I like good showers with waterfall showers. I know they're gonna have nice bed sheets.
But it's you bring that up. That's a good point because you can be somewhere where that's an issue.
Yeah.
But they don't have good showers or, you know what I mean?
Nah.
'Cause I've been places where like say in the Netherlands, I was in Hilversum, their showers are like these little units that mm-hmm. everybody has that can come out and move somewhere else.
Yeah.
It's like a little portable, weird kind of setup.
Yeah, yeah,
so yeah.
Different cultures. I know it sounds funny to even bring something up. I'm like,
but that's real. That's a real thing.
That's like me when I go places. And then also I like motorcycles. So
mm-hmm.
you can ride motorcycles out there. And then there's a sense of freedom that is, it's almost unexplainable, but you can't experience it until you actually go there. So, right. For example, if I'm driving here, so I drive down here to your office, which is incredible, by the way.
Thank you.
Like, I don't think you get enough recognition for what you're doing entrepreneurial wise, right? So people see, like, only thing I know from afar is like, yo, this motherfucker lift weights, he's in shape, you know, doing his thing. And the more that I see the operation, I'm like, yo, this brother is really doing it. And I think that's something that really needs to be, you know, highlighted. And so, but one of the other things that really makes me feel comfortable in Bali is a community. Mm-hmm. So they have a huge digital nomad community and just entrepreneurs, and people just come in and out. So I like to, like, I don't party as much anymore. I mean, I still like to go out, have a good time, but I really like to learn from people. And then, so there's always dope people that I can, you know, in the evening we watch sunset together and we have conversations
really
about life, all these different things, how to build our businesses. So you have a community. So not only can you vacation, but there's a dope community that is there. And you have everything. You have gyms, you have internet, you have restaurants, and like I said, motorcycles. And then, like, going back to that freedom part is, so, oh yeah, when I lost train of thought. So when I was driving down here, I'm always thinking about, am I going to get shot if I get pulled over, but I can't speed too much. There's these rules and restrictions here. Mm-hmm. And I'm not saying it's a bad thing, but everything is rules and restrictions.
Right.
There, bro, I see a police officer, I'm going to speed by him with no hesitation.
Whoa, really?
Like, yeah, it's no hesitation. And
so there's no bad traffic?
If you're on a bike, no. If you're in a car, yes, it can be traffic. Okay. And so that kind of freedom of, you can do whatever you want as long as you're not a dickhead and you're not doing drugs. And right. So I don't do either. So it's like, you can do whatever you want, complete, there's just a sense of freedom. Like, and so that's what I love about Bali.
Okay, that's dope. Yeah, man. I connected you with one of my friends that was out there recently. She just went, see, I never went somewhere for a real long time, especially how busy I am. And she just went for a month. And I talked to her today for the first time since she's been back. Yeah. And she was like, I didn't even want to leave. Wow. See, when I travel, bro, I can't wait to go home. Like, after 4 or 5 days, like, all right, it's time to go home. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I have such a regimen that I'm used to. You know what I mean?
I'll tell you this. So I feel that way if I'm doing a short trip, right? Bali, though, I'm always like, fuck, I'm leaving. Like, Bali's just a different energy.
Wow.
But I like routine. Mm-hmm. So if I'm just there for 5 and I'm doing thing, I'm like, shit, now my business is regressing because I'm not taking care of what I need. Mm-hmm. But if I normally set up, so when I was traveling to these places, I'm there for 6 months. So okay. I get a place. So I'm not in a rush. When people are vacation, they're in a rush
to try to do as much as little time.
But I'm living my life like I would be in California, in Chicago. So I'm like,
sorry about that.
No way. So yeah, I'm enjoying everything at a regular rate. So I'm in routine, so I don't really feel that as much like I'm ready to go home as much.
Right, that's dope. What made you start traveling, and how long are you gonna do this forever? Is this your thing? And do you have a home base?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I live in Oakland now. That's my city, Chicago. I'm from Chicago, born in London. But no, yeah, my base is in Oakland. Mm-hmm. Absolutely love it. Such amazing people. And yeah, I think I will travel for my entire life. I get bored of seeing a new same thing over and over and over again. Mm-hmm. And so that's what gives me, but I like the stability now. Like, I get excited to go home. Like, oh, I'm going to be in my bed. Like, I'm going back to my crib. Mm-hmm. It's real nice. But I do like to experience these different parts of the world, these different cultures, these new places. I see something, I'm like, damn, I want to go see that. I want to go meet that person. And then also, say the people that I meet, that's the number one thing. If you are with the right people in a city, it changes everything. Mm. The right people to show you around, if you have the right inside guys. It's like some people could come to LA, but if you were some lames that don't really know what's what, you're not gonna have the best time.
Right.
But if you have the plug to show you
city, for sure.
It changes your whole
thing. And one thing I like that you do is the people that help you out, or even like someone who's your maid or whatever, you shout everybody out on your videos. This is their contact info. Yeah. You want to use so-and-so, contact them here. I think that's really dope that you giving back to them like that.
Yeah, man, because it's like every opportunity that I have, I mean, if it's on my social media or anything, people might connect to me in a way, but I'm like, they really connect. So like even I was with my boy, you know, Billy Jean, I was with Abdu, they do some of the thing with marketing, but I'm like, yo, they dope brothers. I want to share them. Like a lot of people are like, they want to hoard because like, oh, if I share something, that's going to take away from my shine.
Right, right.
I feel I'm dope enough that it don't matter, man. I'm going to eat. I'm going to shine regardless. And so, and it's always a team effort. Like, we got my man Anthony back here behind the camera. You know, he's been with me for 3 years. And
you mean Conor McGregor?
Conor McGregor. Yo, we got to put the B-roll in to show you what he looked like. And so, it's always a team effort for me. And so, I'm like always, I love to show people because it just feels natural to me because I don't get to where I am by myself, right? Mm-hmm. Look at here, like, we here with the Warriors. I didn't even make the contact for that. Like, you know, producer on my team, Katora, set up everything. Mm. We had the contact. She makes it happen. So when you see these videos, you might just see me.
Right.
But this is whole production. You got
See, trust me, I know what that's like because the Mike Rashid machine is not just Mike Rashid. It's a team of us. And everybody's not here right now. You know, we got like 15 people here. You know what I'm saying? So it's a network of people that's all talented. You know what I mean? Moving in one direction. So I feel you 100%.
And then with the maids, man, or like house cleaners, when I leave these places, like, so like I say, like these incomes, so like in Colombia, minimum wage is about $300 a month. So right, you can get like a full-time house cleaner for that. And you know, she would cook a little bit. So I was like, I pay something close to double that just to like, you know, really show my love.
Right,
but then after I'm gone, you know, that's gone. And she was amazing. So I said, I know when I'm leaving now, just because she ain't going to have a job with me, I was like, I want some of my people that are watching to take care of her the way. And I know they're going to show her respect because she's going to come back and be like, yo, man, the fuck kind of people you sending
right,
me? So
right,
it's
right.
like, I know if they watch, like, they're going to, you know, they're going to be cool with it. And then also pay her well, you know, that. And I was like, yeah, if I can just help that out, I always love to, you know, put people on any way that I can.
Right, right. No, that's dope, man. Yeah, when I was in the UAE, it was the same. The going rate for like say like a driver, these are all full time people. Like they are dedicated to you, a driver, a maid, a nanny, whatever. It's $300 a month, and that goes a long way in their country. You know what I'm saying? Because usually these are dope people. They send the money home. You know what I'm saying? See, there's a little different because you hire somebody, you house them as well. So, but you always have like a maid's quarters on your property. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, so
that's
like,
how it is in the UAE.
Yeah, we don't. So that's a different thing. Like they go home,
right.
Do their thing.
Right, right, right.
But yeah, like they just come
that,
like whatever.
Where I was at, that was a country where people would go there to work though. So it would be like that. They leave, they'd be married or whatever, but you know, they coming from Ethiopia or wherever. They don't have the money, like they don't, the industries are not there. So they come to the closest place.
Yeah.
Where there's a lot of thriving industry and like we here to work, you know what I'm saying? And they usually be dope people too, you know what I'm saying? Yeah.
And I'm sure like they minds are open. I think, I don't know if it's kind of off topic or not, but I think when you're around that too, like the real hustlers that get put into those situations, some will be like, okay, this is my life, I'm just going clean. But then other people, they've got enough hustling mentality in them. You put them in a situation around these, you know, I call them killers, but people who are making shit happen, they like, oh, they start figuring out. They listen to these conversations. You're around bosses. There's like two types of people I've seen in my life. I can bring someone around and they ain't going to level up. And then there's so many people I bring around.
So those people just enjoying the ride, just having fun, and that's it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then these other people I bring around, they're like, damn. These motherfuckers just made $100,000 this week. Like, some people, they're just like, oh, that's just fun. Other people are like, let me start listening deeper to what's going on and paying attention. And then they're going off doing their own thing, you know, making hundreds of thousands a year, making millions a year. And I've seen it time and time again because it's just, it's impossible not to pay attention. Mm-hmm. But it's like, what are you going to do with these networks and everything that you, you know, being introduced when you come around my circles?
Right,
you know?
Right. Nah, it's real, bro. So, okay. So you got Bali, you go to Bali tonight, right?
I go to New Zealand tonight.
New Zealand, okay. Yeah. Okay, you said a wedding?
Yeah, yeah. That's actually one of my mentees, Hannah and Nate. Well, shout out to World Nate. You know, just crushing. He used to be a plumber in New Zealand, right? He sent me a message on Facebook about 8 years ago. Hey, I see you traveling around the world. I see you doing your thing. Is there any way I could learn? I said, all right, do this, do that. And he just came back and done it. You know, you can tell a lot of people that, but then they don't go and do it, right?
Right.
So it's like someone, so like you tell me, you're helping me with like, you know, working out. You're like, all right, do this squat, do this. But like, if you tell me the right shit to do, and now I'm not even showing you the respect to keep practicing, like you world-class elite. But now if I come back, I'm like, all right, Mike, I'm doing this, I'm doing this. Mm-hmm. Now you're like, okay, do this, right? Because you're not going to keep putting energy into someone you're not showing the respect
to do. That's real.
Then so for him, he kept doing, I was like, okay. Now, you know, I don't want to put his business out there, but like, man, been popping off milli years from a plumber in New Zealand back in the day to now.
That's dope.
You know, doing this thing. And so I was like, he's just one of my main men. So literally taking a 13-hour flight to New Zealand to see him and his girl get married.
That's so dope because, you know, people ask me for advice all the time, bro. And even people around me, and I'll like, yo, XYZ, ABC, go this way, jump that way, do this, do that. And the next year they'll ask me the same thing. I'm like, we talked about this. You know what I'm saying? I'll do it again. But when there's a few people around me that have taken what I've given them, those little seeds, and planted it and cultivated it and got their own situations, and it's dope. I love that. I love that. You know what I mean? Shout out to Bounty Tank. That's one of my guys. He got a dope channel, bro. You got to check it out.
Okay.
He's a bounty hunter.
Oh, shit. That's sad.
But he swole dreads. You know what I'm saying? He's a cool, scary bounty hunter. You know what I'm saying? And that's his series is about that. Like, you know, me and him been cool for years. And you know, I took him under my wing years ago. And now he got his own thing. And that's I'm proud of him. Love him to death. You know what I'm saying? I just seen him last week in Detroit. Yeah. You know, that's my guy. So, you know, shout out to Bounty Tech. I love when people, you know, you give them something.
Yeah.
And here's the thing. Giving people wisdom and a blueprint is way more valuable than money. Way more valuable than money. Money is not going to help. The knowledge and the wisdom and the guidance is what, as long as they use it, that's infinite money. You know what I'm saying? So that's one thing, like, you know, to not enable people. Like, all right, here, I need help here. That doesn't help anybody. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But I really appreciate when people do use the advice and the information, and it's respect. You know what I'm saying? Or don't waste my time. You know what I mean? But a lot of people do, especially when we do content, especially informative things. Unfortunately, I feel like a lot of people just get motivated for a minute and then go back to their normal thing. They don't really do anything with it. And I talk shit, too. I'm like, I know y'all ain't going to do nothing with this, but here. You know what I'm saying? Here's some gang. You know what I mean? Because most people don't do nothing with it. Yeah. That's why I'm not big on motivation. I'm like, man, nah. Because me, motivation don't work for me. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, okay, calm down. When I do something for real, I gotta really lock in mentally and do it, and I do it. Yeah. And I feel like that's how people gotta be. When they wanna do something, you know, getting some motivation, it make you feel empowered for that moment. Yeah. But that goes away. Just like it's a feeling. Feelings just come and go. But having that intrinsic way to lock in on the inside, that's what you need. You got to have that self-belief and like, I want to do this. I'm going to make it happen. Yeah. You know what I mean? So, you travel all over the world all the time. It can't be cheap.
Mm-hmm.
How are you able to do this without having a 9-to-5?
Damn, good question. It's like one of the top questions that I get. So, for me, I have a few different things, but the foundation of what I do is based on advertising. With digital ads, so like pay-per-click marketing. So one of the businesses that I've built through pay-per-click marketing is I have a business called the Live Richer Academy with my business partner, Tiffany DeBudgianista. And so what that business is, we teach primarily women on how to improve their finances, right? So teaching them how to budget, teaching them how to save, teaching them how to invest, buy your first investment property. All of those things under the financial umbrella is what we do. And so now the way that we monetize it, right, is, so there's a couple different ways. we have a membership site where, which is called the Live Richer Academy. And so we charge $30 a month for that. And then we have right now currently 26,000 members, you know, within there.
It's not too shabby. It's not too shabby.
Right. And you know, pretty low, but that's not all, you know, it's not all profit. So, cause we also, that's another thing. People blow out the numbers, but it's like, all right, how did the numbers actually break down?
Yeah. It's overhead.
You know, cause we have, you know, we have employees, we have, you know, advertising costs. So with, when we're doing these ads, typically what we see, and the reason I'm breaking it down is because I like people to understand it a little bit deeper 100%. Than versus just 100%. A blanket statement. And so we have, you know, I also have taxes. Fuck it, motherfucker.
Tell me about it.
Right? And so we have typically in an advertising, like, let me explain advertising in as simple as I can do it. So you got like Facebook ads, which is a big thing. You've got Google ads. So now let's say you have a product like this and you want to sell it. So
shout out to Snack House Puffs.
Can I actually try this shit already?
It's yours, bro.
He wanted to
try it earlier. I said, nah, wait till we on camera because I literally want an honest review. I want your honest opinion on it.
Yeah, like I busted off. He's like, no, wait till the cameras are rolling.
All right, let's see.
Let's see.
This is as real as it gets, y'all.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
That tastes like cheesecake.
See? So for y'all don't know about Snack House, it's a new company of myself and Shanto Abadi and a few other people who are involved. And, you know, I like to snack. I'm a snacker. So, you know, we've been talking about doing a snack company. And it wasn't meant to be anything fitness related, just a snack company. And but we just happened to come up with something that's actually really good for you. Each serving is 15 grams of protein, only 3 grams of carbs, and it tastes amazing. And with the sweet, we have sweet and savory flavors. I'm a savory guy, but I love this too. You can use this as a cereal, you know what I mean? Or just as a snack, how you're eating it right now. The savory can be used as croutons, just happen to have protein, or just a snack like chips. It feeds my chip needs. You know what I'm saying? So I used to eat a lot of chips. I don't mess with it no more. Yeah. All the saturated fat, the salt, don't need that. Carbs. So this is perfect, man.
Oh man, nah. I was a little nervous of telling you like if it's shit.
Nah,
so
bro.
So I was like,
I got so much confidence in it. I'm like, let's do it live. Let's do it right here on camera.
Shit, bang it.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, I'm gonna tell you. Like,
take some back to Bali. Nah, take some to New Zealand with you. You know what I'm saying? Yeah.
So where we leave off again?
Shit, I don't know. Oh, you were talking about the financial stuff?
Oh yeah, advertising.
Mm-hmm.
So one thing for me that changed my life. So I used to sell products on eBay. Right? I used to actually sell weight loss supplements on eBay. I thought I was a man. I thought I was a shit. And it was just, I'd list a product and they would be selling. Mm. And back in the day, used to be even do homepage feature listing for $99.
For cheap, right?
So cheap. It's crazy. Products were moving. You know, started breaking through 5 figures a month. And I was like, yo, I'm that man.
And tell the people how old you were.
I was a teenager. Like, I was still in high school. And so.
Making 10 racks a month. Yeah, and better.
Like 10, 20.
Yeah.
So my head was as big as could be. Mm-hmm. And so from there, I was like, man, I got this, man. I don't need nobody. Like, I got this. And then what changed were the eBay algorithms. And then so from there, what used to be super profitable, they took away the homepage feature listing, the feature plus listing. And then it was so difficult to even, I might break a little bit more than even, but the kind of profit margins and the way my life was, all that. And then by that time, the algorithms changed. I've been moved out my mom's house. And so I was just
got a lot of bills.
Got bills and everything. And then before I look at it, I'm like, damn, now I'm running through savings just to survive. And then before you know it, the whole thing has crumbled. And it was one of the greatest learning lessons of my life was I was a one-trick pony. And I see so many people like that right now who, if I could give them advice, give you advice if you're starting out in the business world, is don't rely on just one traffic source to sell your products. It's one of the absolute, why it's going good, it's going to be great. But, and when it falls, it's going to fall, because everything goes up must come down. And any real business, like when you're investing or doing anything, you have multiple sources of income to stabilize what you do. So putting all, like, it is sometimes good to put all your eggs in one basket to do something. But when it comes to this business life, marketing, like, you want to have multiple sources of traffic, right? Because the game is going to change. And so then I went through a three-year learning period of how do I learn how to actually advertise no matter what's going on? So I learned storytelling, right? How to produce amazing content and, you know, communicate to an audience, right? No matter what. Then I wanted to learn pay-per-click marketing, because, like, okay, this is going to be something. I was learning search back then, and then Google content ads. And then as time gone on, it was YouTube ads and Facebook ads. And then with this, I know now that I know how to advertise no matter what is going on organically on YouTube. I learned how to put out, you know, content and put the right keywords. And now you have all this different traffic. And that's where I became, you know, a master marketer. And with that, once you learn how to market something, you can market anything. So I linked up with Tiffany, you know, have done that. I've partnered with people in the fitness business, in the luggage business, and you can do everything. And so what we do with Tiffany is right now we spend about 150, 200 grand a month on ads, and then we bring back in new business right around 300,000, 400,000, give or take. And then the beautiful thing is now that next month we only lose about 8% of those people because of the churn rate.
And you've gained more people.
Right. And so that's one of my main sources of income with what I do. And I have other businesses that I've built like that. And so a lot of people see the videos. I don't really talk about that. And so they wonder how that, you know, how my money works behind the scene. And I tell people, because not everyone wants to be a personality. So with Tiffany, hardly anyone knows I exist unless you read in, like, the Forbes articles or something, you know, like that. Nobody knows that it even exists. Mm-hmm. And so I say, if you want to be a personality, great. But you don't have to be a personality to make money. And the internet right now is one of the greatest ways to make money. The barrier of entry and the upside is just absolutely amazing.
Yeah, man. I'm with you 1,000,000%. I mean, back in 2012, my first company started really bubbling. And it's like, wow, the internet just neutralized the playing field. So I can compete with these big brands. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And, you know, you don't have to be a personality. But being a personality, you can really flip it and monetize mm-hmm. it in a big way. And what people don't do, they don't, they sometimes people are short-sighted. So what they'll do is they'll take a quick dollar from someone who's going to pay them to talk about some product. You know what I mean? When, if somebody's going to give you, let's say, $5,000 a month, mm-hmm. right, to talk about their product to your audience, they're not stupid. They're making probably 15, 20 grand off of you talking about that, mm-hmm. their product. So you could be doing that for yourself. You know what I'm saying? So people, they don't, a lot of people don't have that self-belief or that awareness that they can do it. They're afraid to do it. People used to a paycheck. But I'm like, no, you should be afraid just getting a paycheck, because they can stop it. You know, they can, for whatever reason, stop paying you. And then you rely on that, you asked out. One thing you said, I've been living by this since college. I read Rich Dad Poor Dad mm-hmm. by Robert Kiyosaki when I was like 20 years old. I'm like, this is perfect. The one thing I really took out of that book, he was like breaking it down, like, you know, it's not realistic that everybody's gonna just hit a home run like Steve Jobs. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So you gotta have multiple streams of income. So I've been like that from the start, just like you, man. Like, it now it's gotten to where, you know, certain companies make so much money, we just let it sit, we just reinvest in the business. Yeah. The goal is always to sell at some point, yeah. right? If you're sucking everything out, you're not going to be able to scale in the right way. Because I did have a company, one of my companies, we were just living off the money and it was good money, but we couldn't scale like mm-hmm. that. You know what I mean? When it was like, damn, the demand was coming. We didn't have enough for inventory and shit like that. People don't take that into consideration. But even outside of that, now we like master all of that. Now I have, you know, you have the opportunity to, like, you see an opportunity, like I saw an opportunity with Snack House. Yeah. The capital was there to just easily just take it, yeah. scale up, make it bigger, better. You know what I'm saying? Put it on a bigger scale. And you know, you can take those, you can do those things, but you got to be disciplined with your money.
Yeah.
People, when they're making money, they want to just spend it. You know what I'm saying? You can't do that, right?
Absolutely.
So, well, you shouldn't. You can do whatever you want, but it's not the best thing to do. You know what I'm saying? Because you never know. Like you said, a channel might close, might fall. You know what I mean? And one thing I'm proud of is like my sites all get tons of traffic, tons of sales, right? Whereas there's people that only do Amazon and they kill it. But Amazon is somebody else's situation.
Yeah.
They can punish you. I've heard the horror stories. You know what I mean? If you don't want to play by their rules, the buy button's gone and all kind of crazy stuff. And the fees are heavy. And it's just somebody else's platform at the end of the day. You know what I mean? So, you know, but I play the Amazon game too. But I got my own setup. I got my own e-commerce situation. You know what I mean? And I just, that's why I say and do whatever the fuck I want to do. You know what I'm saying? Because I'm not confined to anybody's rules. I've done deals with companies years ago to where, like, they talk me into doing a brand. They're like, all right, cool. And then they're coming at me about, hey, you know, post like this. Or if not, you know, we kind of dock the pay. I'm like, look, you know what? Just keep your money. I don't take these deals because I hate these stupid emails like this. You know what I'm saying? So we good. Let's just keep the relationship cool. And just, I don't even want to do this. You know what I mean? So people that, and there's so many people, listen, you have, ladies and gentlemen, you got followers on Instagram, whatever. I don't care if it's 5,000. People think that's not a lot. Put 5,000 people in front of you. That's a lot of people. Convert 5% of that a day, 10% of that a day. You making money. You know what I mean? You don't have to have the biggest following to convert. Now, I'm going to say this as well. Have something meaningful to sell or a meaningful service to provide. You know what I'm saying? Because sometimes people are ambitious and want to do something, but they don't have an idea of what they want to do. I feel like the foundation of being successful in business, you got to have the marketing savvy, all of that. But you got to have a quality product or service, you know what I mean? And quality customer service. Treat the people good, you know what I mean? That's the foundation, you know what I mean? Because in the beginning, I made a lot of money with no back end anything, no ads, no nothing. You know what I'm saying? Just on me and my dealings with my network, my community. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, and having dope product or dope services, that's gonna. There's people that I've seen, bro. I've seen, you know, you see so many things in business. I've seen people with whack companies, never really made much money with the company, but they ran everything so perfect, they're able to sell, cash out. Yes, and that blows my mind. But it's even better when you have a dope company and you have everything perfect. You know what I'm saying? Because the cash out is that much greater. You know what I'm saying?
No, man. And I think one of the points that you really made is playing the long game. So when I think, I mean, people might not like the Kardashians, whatever. But I think about at like the highest level when you look at what Kylie has done with her cosmetics line. It would have been so much easier for her to take $10 million a year from Maybelline and, you know, do the thing, and then be under the restriction of Maybelline's rule. You can't do this. Then, and that's how most people have done it.
And you won't make that much money.
You know, and that's the thing, right? And it's like, but that's the way the game has gone before. It's also because of the kind of outlets. But with social media, you are the source of the voice. I don't think people have really caught on fully. Like, when you're being an influencer for these brands, you got to understand you are creating them, not the other way. Before, it's like a little bit, but right now, and I'm so glad that these stories are coming out, you know, like you. And like, when you look at now what she has built, because now she's taking 100% versus just getting paid. And so many of these athletes, I love that the narrative is changing. They're getting into these investment world. So versus just saying, hey, I want a sponsorship deal, like people like Bron and like these people, they're smart enough. Like, no, fuck, I'm the source. I want, like, or 50. These motherfuckers, like, they not just saying I want a sponsorship deal. That's for them rookies. That's for the people who just need that quick money, that need it. But these people that know what their influence can do, or you look at Diddy with Ciroc, with, you know, Diageo, it's like that's the play that I really like people to push now. And be, and once, you know, you build that for the years out, them cash outs and the respect level.
100%. And the wisdom. And then you're able, I got companies that is not necessary for me to be promoting on Instagram that they don't know about. You're able to maneuver in the business world in a bigger capacity. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
So it's like the things that you learn doing your own thing. Because my first company, bro, I had nobody to get advice from. I just roughed it. You know what I'm saying? It took me a little bit long to get everything to where it should be.
Yeah.
But I learned on my own, trial and error. You know what I mean? And that's valuable. I wasn't looking for no deals. I don't want it. I don't see me in the industry, in the fitness industry, I'm not the typical guy. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? So I did things my way, and I wanted to always do things my way.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's just more beneficial for me to do my own thing. You know, I've always been like that. I have no problem being a subordinate to someone, but I got to really respect them and really fuck with what they got going. Because, I have no ego in that capacity. Mm-hmm. I'll gladly be number two to somebody. You know what I'm saying? But I got to really respect them. You feel
Absolutely.
Me? Yeah.
Nah, you giving away game. So.
Yo, we giving y'all game. Use it. I get. We talked about this a little bit earlier. I talked about a sleep product on YouTube. By the time y'all see this, it was yesterday. So the video from yesterday, and what I did was there's four ingredients that we use, right? Really good for you, all natural, and it helps you to where you don't need a sleep product. You know what I'm saying?
Wow.
And it relieves stress, anxiety. It deals with all of these issues, right? And I'm telling people how important sleep is. It's literally a performance enhancement. Mm-hmm. The lack of sleep, it impedes your thinking, your reasoning, your mood, like so many things. And it's literally cutting days off of your life just like smoking cigarettes, right? So I tell people about these ingredients and the product. Go click the link, read up about it. I said, don't even buy it. I said, you probably should buy it, but read about it. I want you to know, because here's the thing. I have so much confidence in, first of all, it's really good for you. My followers are smart people. When they read it, when they're educated on something, they know, all right, let me lock in. This makes all the sense in the world. But you have some people like, you know what? I missed the real mic. It was just workouts. You're just selling stuff. I'm like, look, this is the real mic. The real mic works his ass off and happens to have dope product that he sells to people, right? And I said, look, you don't even buy my stuff. I'm sure you obviously don't. So you're getting free content all the time. For the people that do want to buy, want to optimize their health, yada, 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 and they want to buy my stuff, where else should I talk about it at? I'm asking you, Mr. Know-It-All. You know what I mean, the real mic. So you want me to just work out all day with my shirt off for some dudes on YouTube to just look at me? Nah, bro, I got things to do. I got kids. You know what I'm saying? I have goals and dreams. You know what I'm saying? And no, that's what you want? You know what I'm saying? I'm trying to give y'all a real game. We giving y'all a real game right now. You know what I mean? Because here's the thing. Follow the workouts. That's great. Like, being in shape, I mean, there's no reason, there's no need for me to really talk or go into the benefits of being in shape. Yeah. But I'm trying to get y'all into financial shape as well. This man literally does that. You know what I mean? I'm going to link your info down below for people to sign up for what you got going, because that's amazing. You know what I'm saying? And the fact that you have a very low churn rate means that what you're providing is very valuable and useful. You just said you took the guy from New Zealand under your wing, and now he's popping off, making millions of dollars.
Yeah.
Right? It's valuable. So it's something that y'all want to do. Like, and he's not paying me to do this. I want people to make money. I want people to be successful. The world would be a better place if people had more confidence and was doing all right for themselves. You know what I'm saying?
1,000,000%. I feel like, I believe this with every ounce of my art. Confidence will allow you to do so many things. So many people are timid. And so for me, one of the exercises that I've done is, if I really fear something, I would go and do it, right? Run even when it. We're doing like that exercise, and like if I don't get something, I don't want to stop. I want to keep going until I actually get it. Or like maybe I was like scared of like the most beautiful women before. And then the more that you talk, you're like, oh shit, human beings. But like everything is this mind game, you know, inside of your mind. Anything that scares me, I want to, it fucking kills me if I can't get through it. And going back to like helping people and like really leveling up, so many people have these great ideas, but they just don't know how to, you know, execute them. Or I could talk about this other guy, Lars. He has this game called Vertalis. So he's you're talking about the Netherlands before, right? Mm-hmm. So he's from the Netherlands. And then in this generation, we are on our phones too much. We're on Instagram too much. We just use social media, period. That shit is a drug. Mm-hmm. And so he created this card game. He did a little GoFundMe. Indiegogo, where you rate, and he sold about 200 units. Mm-hmm. And the game is based on bringing people together. And the questions are like, so you play it with friends and family. And the questions are like, all right, so you're sitting around. It's like, all right, what's one thing that you want to change about yourself in the next, you know, year? Or what was the most exciting thing that's happened? You know, whatever. Just like deeper, meaningful questions that you'd go around. Or like, what's one thing you actually want to change about yourself? All these different type of questions in a card game, $25, put it out. And they sold 200. Then he started to use ads. And from that, the first 100, he made 300 back. So it went big. And he's like, oh, shit.
But that's a 3X return.
3X return, so something switched on. And then here's the thing. So many people are so close. So he had been listening to podcasts for years, fucking hustling, doing this, going through advertising courses, all this different shit. So 4 years building to get to this right thing, has the product. And then from there, he's like, oh, shit, talk to his partner. And they said, let's put some more money in advertising. You know, put 500 and got 1,500 back. Like, this is a true story. Mm-hmm. 2 months later, so he'd been making about $1,000, $2,000, just hustling, doing all these little things. Month two, he's doing $100,000 in revenue because now he understood the power of advertising and taking that idea and scaling it up. And I just recently ran into him in, we're in Singapore. He spent $300,000 on ads and brought back $900,000 that month. That's about a year ago. I ran into him in Singapore, and then I remember him. I was in Bali. He taps on my shoulder. I feel like because I didn't know him. He was just watching my videos on YouTube, and it's like, Mr. Think Outside the Box. And then so I started to talk to him, learn more, and I was like, oh shit. And that was my business partner. I saw about the corner of my eye back there. And then so that's the thing. Like, you can take an idea. And with the right advertising and with ads, and nobody even really knows who he is. Like, I mean, he's got his Forbes articles and whatnot, but just use ads to scale it up. So I really tell people, if you can learn some skill set, like, I really feel advertising is one of the most powerful things, and you become really valuable. And it's the speed, because with organic traffic like YouTube or something is great, but it's like it grows. You can't have a viral video, but with ads, you can force virality.
Mm-hmm. Right, and that's the key, man, just getting in front of people. I used to be, like, against ads back, because, bro, honestly, man, I made lots of money organically, so I was kind of cocky. But my boy was like, there's no...
Both.
Yeah, let's get it all. All right, let's do it. And then when we turned it on, it's like, all right, this is good. This is good. This is good. You know, when you get hitting them from the front and the back, it's a good thing. Not like that. That did sound kind of fucked up, but that's not what I mean. The front end marketing and back end. That's what I'm talking about. So, you know, getting them into that funnel and able to really work everything, you know, so we can't get into all of that on we don't got all the time, but you know, but it's a dope world. I love when I meet people like you who do things that similar to what I do, we always hit it off. It seemed like it's all a certain type of breed of people, you know what I mean? And we I worked out with Jermaine. We both know Jermaine. Legend. Jermaine Griggs.
Hey, those are the Obamas. Shout out to Jermaine. That's big homie from, I just recently met him about a year in person. It was recently, actually like 3 months ago, 2 months ago, something. And I've watched him from afar for like 10 years.
Okay.
So in the marketing space, this guy is a marketing legend. And he's just him and his family are such a beautiful people.
Good people.
Good people. And so, he's another one that just makes stuff happen. Mm-hmm. Quiet. You know, you see him walk down the street and won't even know it.
He hit me up the other day. We met in the barbershop, actually, but the other day, you know, we exchanged numbers and whatnot. Another day, he hit me up like, hey, man, you know, Mike got him on his own. He was like, if you don't mind, I like to come work out with y'all in the morning, yada, yada, yada. I'm like, you know what? He's a quality human being.
Yeah.
And with me, my training is not just my physical, but it's mental. It's therapy. Like, like it's me and my business partner. We're good friends. Yeah. When I say business partner, because we are business partners, but we're like homies. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And we train together, and we hit the sauna, and we're talking ideas, business every day. Right? It's very valuable because we can map a lot of things out. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, why not have another person mm-hmm. in that mental sparring that we do every day? Yeah. I love that. You know what I mean? So he came, he loved it, and he signed up at where we go. Like, I talked him into it, you know what I'm saying? I told him, call this sales guy, right? He's going to hook you up. And I told the guy, hook him up, make sure you hook him up, him and his fam. And he did, and he signed up yesterday. So that's powerful, bro. You know what I'm saying? Because just imagine if me and you see each other every day, and we build every day. You know what I'm saying? So, like, let's say my business partner, Sean, who I was talking about earlier. You know, we've been business partners for a few years, mm-hmm. but we lived in different states, and we're doing great. Yeah. But when we moved to the same state, and we like damn near neighbors, the shit has been accelerated. Yeah. All of the things that we can do that we're doing, you know what I'm saying? So 2019 was a phenomenal year, you know. Every year people are like, dude, how was your year? Like, it was good. No, ours is quantifiably great. You know what I'm saying? It's like, look at this.
Yeah.
You know, this, we were just here, now we way up here. Like, mm-hmm. it's exponential. So, and there's no reason to stop. So, when all of these powerful minds and like minds come together, man, it's fun.
Oh, no, it's fun. So much fun. Like,
and making money is fun. And it's not like the sense of just like the greedy capitalist. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Because everything that I do, I feel like is of service to people. So, I call myself a conscious capitalist. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, I feel good about everything, every product and every service that I provide. I feel excellent about it. That's why I go so hard pushing it. Like, I'm not embarrassed. Mm-hmm. I'm not embarrassed to market my and sell my shit, to pitch my shit. You know what I'm saying? I'm not, because the people that's on board already, they love it. And they're getting so much value from it. So I'm going to always push that shit to the max.
Man, I love that. It's funny. Jermaine was literally texting me this morning. He's like, damn, my legs still hurt.
Yeah.
Like, my legs hurt from...
He was tweaking his squat, tweaked his squat form. You know what I'm saying?
Myself included. But I just kind of want to get close to wrapping up on what you just said about actually doing good work. So even going back to the reason I link with Tiffany, people ask me to like partner and run ads. And I've been watching Tiffany... for probably about 3 years before that. And she's like, oh, I don't think I got the budget to work with you. I was like, it's not about that. Like, I look at where we can go and who are you as a human being. Because a lot of people are just like, they're about the quick buck of just a marketing gimmick. And I'm like, that shit's whack. Mm-hmm. And so I saw her foundation. Her foundation was so pure in what she was doing. I said, okay, I can help. Because she's like, I was like, what you've been doing? I was like, what are you doing in affiliate marketing? And she's like, I've never done anything in affiliate marketing. She's like, everything is like organic. And so she had about a list of 10,000 on the email, 10,000 fans. And the funny thing is, what you're talking about ads too, she's like, I ain't going to pay for ads. Like, get my shit for free.
Yeah.
And then now, you know, we can't spend enough money on ads. And so it's always a win-win situation for everyone in that business, right? So the people that we help, you know, financially, and like our membership site, it's $30. Like, there's no crazy, like, hey, now you got to buy this $1,000 thing or this left loop lift. Like,
right,
it's
right.
just, it's very straightforward and people know what they're getting. And so they're winning. The customer is winning because they're getting this education. And a lot of people, they always tag in their homegirl. Or if someone's like, nah, this is too good to be true, they battle for us in the comments of the ads saying, like, yo, no, she's a real deal. I've been in there for 2 years. Right. This shit is the real deal.
Right, yeah. And so I love that.
They go hard. Next is Facebook is happy, right? Mm-hmm. They getting their ad money or these platforms. And then we're happy. We're building our businesses, and we sleep good at night. And then also the family. So it's like you teach a woman, now you're teaching that family. And then also now you're teaching a community. So the stuff that we are doing will literally have generational impact on, you know, what it is. We're not just doing empty work. Like, we're really doing generational, you know, type of work. Or if we're working with an affiliate partner. So, for example, we're one of the biggest affiliates for some of these companies, like Credit Sesame, similar to Credit Karma, like they're the second biggest. And so, you know, we put people, the company's happy that they're getting quality people, the people are happy they got this good app that's working, we're happy, you know, we're making money and, you know, making an impact. So there's this like misconception of you can't make money and do good work. And right, that is not true.
Yeah, it's not true at
that's
all.
Like another one of these misconceptions until you get around people and hang around, because there's this thing of like the Scrooge, and it's like if you get money and if you're not on that side, it's easy to point fingers and be like, nah, fuck them people, man. Make money is evil. It's not true, man. Like you can be a fuck boy and get money and you can be good.
Money is not a living thing. It's a tool. It could mm-hmm. be used for bad, but it could be used for good. Yeah. And good people get it, bad people get it, whatever. It's not a thing. People in their weird ways is fucked up. You know what I mean? People can be evil. Money can't be evil. You know what I mean? Money helps. The more money I have, the more I can do for people. You know what I mean? And on the flip side, if you have a lot of money and don't do shit for anybody, that's okay too. Yeah. No one's obligated to do anything for anybody. People will be complaining because they ain't doing shit. And they see other people doing shit and they fear what they don't understand, hate what they think they can't conquer or achieve. But fuck that. Just don't focus on self and better your situation. Listen and learn. Ask questions. You know what I'm saying?
That's something you do great. You ask questions. Amazing.
That's what it's about.
I see you around. And then a lot of the smartest people that I know, I actually just posted this on Instagram. My homie, Billy Jean, he's also in marketing. Every time I'm around him or I bring someone around and he knows this, like, he is just lays it in mm-hmm. on asking questions. Some people will be around the smartest people and they want to talk about some bullshit. And he's like, let me use this opportunity to actually right. better myself.
Right.
And I always pick up on people who have the awareness to ask questions and enable themselves to be helped. I'm telling you, it's one of the best things that you can do is...
Oh, yeah. Listen, I have my fair share of bullshit. Yeah, yeah. I like to fucking hang out and just be silly. I'm a child. I'm a grown child. But I ask a lot of questions. I always have. Even in school, I have to ask all the stupid questions so I can understand. And I even, when I know I'm going to have a lot of questions, I'm like, look, I just don't know. This is out of pure ignorance and I want to know. This is how I learn. So I ask a lot of questions just so I can... Because sometimes people are asked questions, they get answer, and they don't want to bother the person with further. But I think anyone conveying information, the bottom line is whoever is listening to understand it. That's what you want. Mm-hmm. Or you're talking for no reason. So I think it's honoring the person by asking more questions so that you have I know what they're trying to say to me. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's just to me, that's the best case scenario. So yeah, I'm a question asker. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to tell you a funny story. I even used it for evil when I was a kid, when I was in school. So I would legitimately be asking questions. And my mother was on some like, don't leave those classes until you understand whatever that lesson was. So ask questions. So that's probably the spark, the seed that got me into asking so many questions. So I would do that. And the teachers were nice and they would answer. I was like, oh, I'm eating up time. So I'm going to keep asking questions. So I would just keep asking stupid ass questions. But what does that mean? Because that's endless. It's infinite, the amount of questions you could ask. And my teacher kind of caught on. I remember one time she told my mom, but that's something you can't get in trouble for. I'm like, I was just asking questions. She was like, yeah, he's trying to make us make me look silly in class. I'm like, mom, I didn't understand. I was asking questions. Yeah. Little badass. But nah, bro, listen, I know you got to go. You got a plane to catch. But listen. We're going to do way more stuff together, man, for real, man. You're a breath of fresh air, bro.
Thank you.
You know what I'm saying? Love the channel. Y'all make sure y'all check out Passport Heavy. And also, what's the name of what's the site for the financial
guidance? Yeah, look up. I say one of the easiest ways is go follow my business partner, Tiffany the Budgetista. And then she comes up. She got books. She's on TV every week as well. But the academy is called Live Richer Academy.
Live Richer Academy.
What percentage of your audience is men and women?
It's like 80-20 men.
Okay. So that's similar to like my Passport Heavy audience. It's like 80% men, 20% women. So they're like, our audience, we literally promote to women. So if you are a male going in there, you know, just know your role. It's 99% women and they run shit in there. But yeah.
Funny thing, in my challenges, the women spank the men.
Mm-hmm.
But so we had to make it more fair, I had to separate to where men get their prizes and women get their prizes because the women was dominating.
Nah.
Women are strong, bro.
Nah. But if you want to learn about the marketing, though, I'll drop a link in that. So I have like a free class where I show people like to open people's mind of like, all right, I can't, like, I'm getting it, but how does it actually, mm-hmm. you know, break down? And right, that's like right. my add value.
Dope, man. Appreciate it, man. So you gonna be in New Zealand, right?
Yeah, yeah. So tonight, fly out to New Zealand, then gonna be in Bali, and then head back to the motherland, Senegal.
Senegal, dope, dope. When is that?
That's March 12th. Gonna be in Senegal.
I will go with you, bro. But I got a fight 2 weeks after that.
I'm excited to see you, man. I can't wait to watch, man. Like I said, it's been an honor to.
No doubt.
Like I've seen you from afar for years, right. Like. You know, and so it's just an honor to be around. And then, like you said, you know, just connecting on just some regular shit. Well, not regular shit, but you know,
yeah, similar energies and frequencies. Yeah. But after March, I'm good. April, we going somewhere. Where you going? Like, I'm coming. So, I'll meet you there.
Like May, I believe May. We in Nigeria. Then we in. I'll send you the schedule. But yeah, we out here, man. I talk a lot of people. Like one of my favorite things to do is be around the world with like-minded individuals is one of my favorite ways to travel. Mm-hmm. Because then I'm like, obviously, we having fun, but then you just naturally, like, I don't think people understand that for me, like I said, when I'm with my homies and my friends, like, sometimes if we ain't in business together, or if they don't have a business, we're not talking about business too much, but, you know, give them a look. But, like, when I'm with that kind of crowd,
right.
We talk about business for fun. Like, it's not a stress.
Because
like,
it is
we
fun.
Literally
yeah.
just talk about, right. all right, this is what's working here.
Well, you tend to talk about things that's going on in your life.
Yeah.
And people like us, it's mostly business stuff. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? So that's what we're talking about. Yeah. And we're sharing, we're exchanging notes. We're talking different tactics and stuff like that. You know, shout out to Simeon Panda. I don't know if you met him yet or not.
No, I haven't met him, but seen him from afar as well.
That's my bro. And, you know, that's a good friend. We travel mm-hmm. together and all of that. But we're always talking business and different tactics. And, yeah. okay, did that work for you? Okay. And we watch each other's back. So right. when there are brand deals presented to me or to him, we like, yo, what did they offer you? Like, nah, yeah. nah, this is what they can pay. So make sure you get this. You know what I'm saying? We keep each other. We make sure everybody, there's no ego shit. It's like, yeah. you know what I'm saying? So, yeah, this is what I got, but I was told from an inside source that this is the budget. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
There's a deal that he and I both got. I had it first, and they were underpaying me, and then somebody from the inside told me. I said, okay, so I'm going to negotiate that the next time. But when they came to him, I said, they came to him with the same deal they offered me. I said, nah, bro, they can pay this. This is where we're at, what we should be getting. And he got it.
I love that.
And then when
man.
they came back to me when my contract was over, I said, nah, I need this.
Yeah.
They still tried to lowball me. I said, nah, I need this, or it's okay. And they came correct. So when everybody's on the same page, can't nobody get over on us. You know what I'm saying?
Bro.
We got to look out for each other.
I don't know how, but I don't know what time it is, but I'm going to end on this. Man, shit, I know you got to go. But that talks about my business partner. So she just got... she's got a book deal. So my one girl, my home girl, Lovey, she has a book called I'm Judging You. And then so she, I won't say the amount that she got, but it was like grossly, whatever. Like she got a price. And then so then she was able to talk to Tiffany and they were able to come together. And then so because she'd been through the whole process, now she was able to negotiate something way better mm-hmm. because she wasn't coming in blind. And I feel that's one of the things that we can do as a community. We do that in Oakland as well, where we, even though I'm not in the job world, we bring people together. So it's like, yo, you looking to go work for Google? You going to look for Facebook out in the Bay? All right, these are the things you need to know. Here's how you can prep for an interview. And we have like mastermind dinner parties and like prepping our people of like, because you're going into this new world that you don't know. And it's like, all right. And now you can go in with confidence because you kind of know what to expect versus like this intimidated person because you ain't got no type of idea. And I feel that's one of the most powerful things that we can do as a collective mm-hmm. is come together to help prep people to get people to the next level. Because that's only, in turn, the only thing that we ask is, so now when you get on, you gonna do that same
reciprocate
thing for someone else.
Correct. Nah, that's dope, bro. Yo, this is a pleasure, my man.
Thank
Let's do
you.
It again. Let's do it again soon. Safe travels. And you too. We out of here. Peace.